Vindicate me, O Lord, for I have walked in my integrity, and I have trusted in the Lord without wavering. Prove me, O Lord, and try me. Test my heart and mind. For your steadfast love is before my eyes, and I walk in faithfulness to you. I do not sit with the worthless, nor do I consort with hypocrites. I hate the company of evildoers, and I will not sit with the wicked. I wash my hands in innocence, and I go around your altar, O Lord, singing aloud a song of thanksgiving and telling all your wondrous deeds. O Lord, I love the house in which you dwell, and the place where your glories abide. Do not sweep me away with sinners, nor my life with the bloodthirsty. Those in whose hands are evil deceives, and whose right hands are full of bribes. But as for me, I walk in my integrity. Redeem me and be gracious to me. My foot stands on level ground. In the great congregation, I will bless the Lord. From the Old Testament, Job 1, the first verse, and then Job 2, verses 1 to 10. There was once a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. That man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. One day the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord and Satan, and also came among them to present himself before the Lord. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from, Satan?" answered the Lord, "From going from fro on the earth and to and from walking up and down on it." The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. He still persists in his integrity. Although you incited me against him to destroy him for no reason," then Satan answered the Lord, "Skin for skin, all that people have, they will give to save their lives. But stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, he is in your power. Only spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and inflicted loathsome sores on Job from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. Job took a potsherd with him to scrape himself, and sat among the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still persist in your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as any foolish woman would speak. Shall we receive the good at the hand of God and not receive the bad?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. In the New Testament, Hebrews 2, verses 5 to 12. Therefore, we must pay greater attention to what we have heard so that we do not drift away from it. For if the message declared through angels was valid, and every transgression or disobedience received a just penalty, how can we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? It was declared at first through the Lord, and it was attested to us by those who heard him, while God added his testimony by signs and wonders and various miracles, and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed among his will. Now God did not subject the coming world about which we are speaking to angels, but someone has testified somewhere. What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now, in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters in the midst of the congregation. I will praise you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Job. It also presents us with the beginnings of a crisis for the main character. In the first chapter of Job, we are introduced to the setup of this crisis. There is a God in the heavens who's conversing with the Hasatan, which is really, in Hebrew, literally means adversary, but is often translated, as we heard, as Satan. These two characters, God and the adversary, strike up a conversation about a man named Job, who we were introduced to in the first 5 verses of Job. He's introduced as an affluent, blameless, and righteous man. He was so righteous that he offers sacrifices for his children who may have sinned. During this setup, we also begin to notice this legal language that opens us to viewing this story as if it were sort of a court hearing. The adversary, or prosecutor, begins to question God's fondness of Job. He believes that Job would not be faithful to God if he had things taken away from him, because he had been given an abundant life. So he proposes that if Job lost all that he had, he would then curse God or say some bad word against God. So God grants permission. Take everything away, but do not do bodily harm. So the adversary begins this interrogation. He takes all of Job's possessions. And before he begins to question Job, he takes and kills all of his 10 children. Surely this will cause Job to say a bad word against God. The plot is beginning to build. But if we read on, the text reveals that the adversary failed. Job didn't, after all this, say any bad word against God. Now begins the really interesting part that hooks us in. The scene goes back to the heavens, where God and the adversary are beginning again to talk. The prosecutor argues that if he's just granted permission to do bodily harm, then surely he could get a confession out of him. God grants that permission again, saying this time only not to kill him. The scene moves back to Job's world, where we find Job inflicted with boils all over from head to toe. Surely this time he will say something against God. We must know the resolution. This is it. What is it? What is it? Is it going to do it or not? Would you, if you were Job? So let's move back. The scene goes back to Job, who is sitting there scraping at all of the boils all over his skin. And entering mysteriously is Job's wife, who says, "Do you still persist in your integrity? Curse God and die." Job immediately replies, "You speak as any foolish woman would speak. Shall we receive the good at the hand of God and not receive the bad?" So that's it. He did it. He successfully endured all the suffering, never questioning his faith. But wait, there's still 40 more chapters to go. The scene changes again, and we find Job sitting with his 3 friends, silently, for 7 days and 7 nights. Will Job, after sitting in his suffering, his pain, for 7 days, now confess something bad against God? Will he question his faith? Well, Job finally speaks. And what does he do? He curses the day he was born. He begins questioning his faith. He begins shaking and questioning God. Some of you may know that one of my favorite ways to study scripture is by looking at the minor characters in the story. The characters who are often glanced over to be focusing on more pertinent characters. Perhaps you've forgotten about the character I'd like to focus on today, because she only had one line. But in my exploration of today's text, I couldn't help this one unnamed character to notice her importance. Some of you may recall that I've said before that names are really important during this time. A name gives you significance. To be unnamed meant she was not important. In fact, Mrs. Job, as I like to refer to her as, is so unimportant that this is the first and only time she ever appears in the entire book of Job. I wanted to understand more of who Mrs. Job was. And why was she included in the story in the first place? As I began my exploration, it became very evident that the one verse dedicated to this Mrs. Job was the turning point in the story. Without her words, the rest of the story would not exist. I didn't come to this conclusion immediately. I first had to figure out what the story is telling us about Job. Using the text itself, we can presume some things about Mrs. Job. First, that she is likely the mother of his 10 children. We can also presume that Mrs. Job, like Job, lived the affluent life, having servants tend to most, if not all, of her needs. We also know that she is suffering, because not only Job loses his 10 children, she does too. No words can express the deep pain of a loss of a child. Mrs. Job has experienced the unimaginable loss of all of her children. Sure, Job is suffering, but Mrs. Job is suffering too. Finally, the last aspect we can presume from what we have in the text is that Mrs. Job becomes the primary caretaker. She's the only one not to have said to be inflicted with disease. Her life, the wonderful life, is gone in a flash. She has to now care for everything, including her husband. She was probably questioning God, why God was allowing all this suffering to come to her, and especially her righteous husband. She begins by her statement questioning her faith and theology. We can infer a lot from the text, but scholars use other ancient texts to help us understand better the scripture text. And one of those I explored was the Septuagint, which is a Greek translation of the original Hebrew Old Testament, which has Mrs. Job speaking more than the one line she's given in the biblical passage. From the Septuagint, we learn more about Mrs. Job. We learn more about her suffering because it's more visible. And in the book of the Septuagint, we also learn that Mrs. Job is definitely the mother of those 10 children. We also know that she is wandering because she is trying to find work to support her and her husband. Now, another ancient text that I have used, and that many have used, is the Testament of Job. These testaments are forms where elders gather their family around to talk about their life and the final instructions. And in this ancient text, the reader is informed that Mrs. Job is, in fact, the mother of the first 10 children, but later dies a bitter death before she sees the end of the story. We are also given a name for her, Sittus. And like the Septuagint, Mrs. Job expresses her misery over her loss. We also know that Job was very fond of his wife and loved her deeply. Finally, it tells us that she laments everything. Using these ancient texts can offer a clearer understanding of what's going on here. So let's turn back to the story. The scene opens, and Mrs. Job appears. She is exhausted from her suffering, but still trying to be the good caretaker. She gathers water to go to her husband to help heal his wounds. And she finds him wallowing in pain, and the suffering is more than she can bear. She cannot hold it back anymore. Out of the suffering, out of the exhaustion, out of the anger and doubt, she lets it out. Must you continue to hold fast to what you believe? Why not curse God and die already? Those are some strong words. Mrs. Job's statement is so strong that several ancient forefathers, like Augustine and Calvin and many others, viewed Mrs. Job as Satan's helper. And as a result, they wrote Mrs. Job off. Many more modern commentators would argue otherwise, myself included. Much of the argument stems from this Hebrew word, barak, which could mean curse, but is more often used as bless. This word is very ambiguous. It could mean that she is saying either bless God and die, or curse God and die. So if we look at this from one commentator's perspective, with the legalistic language that I mentioned earlier, then Mrs. Job is the first to offer Job a way that would oppose the violent, unjust legal system with which he was a victim of. She suggests martyrdom. Again, keeping in mind this legalistic language, Mrs. Job could be using this word barak, meaning both bless and curse, as a means of pushing him into making a choice. In some ways, Mrs. Job can be viewed as extremely wise. It is she that comprehends what is going on in this legal battle, and it is she who encourages Job to oppose the violent acts. If we look at what Mrs. Job is saying from yet another commentator's perspective, we see Mrs. Job very differently. This commentator translates what Mrs. Job is saying as, do our actions and the way in which we speak about God decide the way in which we are either rewarded or punished? What is being suggested is that Mrs. Job asks the important question, the question that the story seeks to resolve. Another commentator believes Mrs. Job as acknowledging the discord between the religious norms and the absolute honesty. According to this commentator, Mrs. Job perceives that her husband is being deceitful if he continues to follow these religious norms by blessing God. But if he stays true to his honesty, he would curse God, going against all of the social norms. And yet another commentator suggests that there is poor communication between Job and his wife. This commentator believes that Mrs. Job responded the way she did because she was only reacting out of frustration from the poor communication. And again, another commentator points to her suffering as a wife, mother, and caretaker. This commentator suggests Mrs. Job feels that cursing God would bring Job's death sooner, relieving him of his pain. Keeping this in mind, she hoped he would curse God so that she didn't have to see him suffer anymore. In her mind, if God is responsible for all this suffering, then Job has any right to curse God. There are so many ways to view this minor, unnamed character. Like others, I would argue that Mrs. Job is vital to the story, to the message of Job. She is the one who begins the discussion that will take place in the remaining three quarters of the book. She is relevant, and she should not be glanced over. Why? Because she is so relatable. She can relate to anyone who has suffered the loss of a child and the questioning of one's faith during that process. She can relate to the spouse who is in a poorly communicating marriage, who speaks out of their frustration. She can relate to the bold person who was the first to ask the tough questions of God after a period of great suffering. She can relate to the caretaker who wants so badly to help out, but out of exhaustion speaks words they didn't really mean. She can relate to anyone who has suffered and had their faith shaken, rightfully questioning God. I can relate to her. Can you? But the great news is, the story goes on. This broken Mrs. Job has an impact, and a positive one at that. Her relatability reminds us that God's story goes on. And we can question God in our moments of suffering, like she did, and like she encouraged Job to do. God wants us to be in relationship. God wants us to find characters in the Bible that we can relate to. We know this because God sent the perfect character, the perfect example. God sent God's Son to die because he loved us, and he wants to be in relationship with us. That's what this Easter season reminds us of.